Hello, everyone. I am Secretary of Education Miguel Cardona, and I am really, really excited to celebrate National Parent Involvement Day. You're going to meet some of my coolest friends at the Department of Education very soon. I appreciate the heart. I appreciate the clapping emojis. I appreciate the love. Thank you for joining us. It's going to be a great event today. Thank you for being here. You know, to start off, I think it's really appropriate to draw some inspiration from my own parents who are as involved and as inspiring as they come. I'm going to start with a really quick story. 5 years ago, my father was inducted into our hometown Hall of Fame in Meriden, Connecticut. He retired from the police force with over 3 decades of service and too many accolades to name. What he said at his induction ceremony was really powerful. He shared this. He said, in order for you to be good with people, you have to be good with yourself. He said, I'm the root of my family. And if the root is not good, the branches will not flourish. As parents, we are all the roots of our families. Because our jobs are so important, they feel very hard sometimes. I know this firsthand. You know, the title I take the most pride in is Papi. That's the title that I'm most proud of, Papi. I'm the proud father of a son and a daughter. Look, parents, we've got to take care of ourselves so that our branches, our kids, grow healthy and grow strong. And so if I can extend my father's tree metaphor just a little bit more, I'll say this. Redwood trees, right? Redwoods, they're the tallest trees in the world. They have shallow roots, usually less than 10 feet deep. But they grow to heights of 350 feet or more. How is that possible? It's possible because their roots spread out, intertwining with those of other redwoods. They quite literally, they hold each other down. As parents and caregivers, we are our children's first and most influential teachers. Their best advocates. We are their roots. And we grow stronger together. Since the beginning of this administration, the president has prioritized authentic family engagement, true partnerships with parents in education. When we provided almost $125 billion for education through the American Rescue Plan, just months into him being president, we required that states and districts engage parents in how they spend those funds. I can tell you, families, we kicked back applications from different states because they didn't involve parents enough. The parents had to be a part of the development of plans. We're always looking for ways to help schools and districts develop genuine and authentic partnerships with parents and families, with all parents and families. Importantly, we've been listening and we've been engaging with parents ourselves. One thing we heard is that parents were not sure where or how to start conversations between home and school. That's why we released an updated parent checklist focused on sample questions to help guide conversations with parents, families, teachers, and school staff. You can check out this checklist on our website, ed.gov, and share it with your schools and with your communities. There's a lot of other cool information you could find on our website that's really parent-friendly, family-friendly, so that you know you can see what supports we have. We're excited about working together with you. Since the president took office, my team and I have met with more than 10,000 parents. We're not done. Parents and families, like so many of you here today, have all confirmed what I learned from my father. We all want the best for our children. That's why we got to build strong, stable roots in our homes and in our communities. And when we work together, our kids can reach the highest heights. Thank you. And now it's my pleasure to introduce Grace Bastidas. Grace is the editor-in-chief of Parents and the first person of color to hold that leadership position for the 97-year-old brand. Grace is a regular contributor on shows you may have heard of, like Good Morning America, Today, and CBS Mornings. Grace is also the voice behind the podcast, that new mom life. She counts U.S. Supreme Court Justice Sonia Sotomayor as one of her favorite interviews of all time. Most importantly, Grace is a mom. She's the proud mother of two daughters, and she, like me, believes that her identidad Latina and bilingualism are her superpowers. Grace, I'm excited to get into the discussion.
Well, thank you for that lovely introduction, and I'm honored to be here today with you on National Parents Involvement Day. And speaking of, your kids are in high school and college. How do you balance your involvement in their education and letting them follow their own path?
Yeah, that's a great question. As I said before, I'm a husband and father before I'm secretary, and it's critical that not only that I balance it, but that I learn from their experience. You know, when we talk about simplifying FAFSA or making sure higher education options exist for students, I have a senior in high school that's going through that process right now. When we talk about safe college campuses, I have my son is in college right now. I want the same for everyone's kids that I want for my own kids. It is a balance, and it's important to make sure that I let them grow in the way that they want to grow and learn and take risks and do what we all did when we kind of were finding our own way through. Like I said, at home, I take off the suit, the tie, and I'm papi.
So you've talked about how as a kid, some people had low expectations of you, and that only made you hungrier.
Yeah.
How did your own parents help you push through that mindset?
Yeah, you know, and I look at the parents that I've worked with over the years. You know, I always say, you come as you are. Parents, you are your child's first and most influential teachers. And your child needs you more than they need anybody else. Us educators, we're a supporting cast. So I think how I overcame low expectations on me, because I did. I grew up in an environment in some places, not all, where there were people that assumed a lot of things. I grew up in an environment where, you know, 70, 80% of the kids were on free or reduced lunch. You know, I came in learning Spanish before I learned English. So, you know, it wasn't, I was afraid of school. My first day of school, I had to go home early. I didn't want to go back. But like you said, my parents' confidence in me, they believed in me when I didn't even believe in me. So parents, you don't have to have a degree in teaching. You don't have to have, you know, fancy letters after your name or be experts in the content that your kids are learning. You got to look your kid in the eye and say, you got something. For me, my parents always stressed pride in who you are. We didn't come with a lot. I always say I was born rich, but without a lot of material possessions. I had a rich family. I had amazing parents. I have a brother and a sister. We grew up tight, believing in each other, supporting one another. And, you know, that's my message. Like, you know, you gotta look within first. And if you believe in yourself, you can accomplish anything.
I love that. Now, you've been an educator for a long time, but what have each of your kids taught you about life?
Oh, my gosh. Grace, you know, the best job I have and the hardest job is being a father. That's, you learn from your kids, you know, and I think, you know, my children are so different. You know, they're wired so differently, and my wife and I just marvel at how they're their own people, right? It's really just making sure that I just give them the space to grow. It's hard when, you know, my wife is in education also. It's hard when your father's a teacher or the school principal or the district leader or the commissioner, now secretary. It's hard. Kids have a lot of pressure these days. But it's important to make sure that, you know, they grow and that we learn from them. And they'll give you the signals of when they need you. And they'll give you the signals when they need to learn by doing, right? And I think for me, the message and my learning from them is that sometimes we got to let them grow and take their lead as opposed to thinking that we have all the answers because we had an experience in the past. And I learned to just enjoy every day and smile every day. They really bring out the best in my wife and me. And as I said, I love being a father so much. It helped me be a better secretary, because there's nothing that I would do as Secretary of Education that I don't think about through the lens of a father. You know, would I want that for my kid? So they've taught me a lot.
Well, thank you so much for sharing a little bit about your life as a papi, right? Or a dad, Secretary Cardona. It's such a nice way to kick off today's webinar. So now we're going to hear a little bit more about parent engagement from Cecily Darden, the U.S. Department of Education Special Advisor for Family Outreach.
Hi. Thank you, Grace and Secretary Cardona. I share the Secretary's excitement and commitment to engaging families in education. As a mom of two amazing young men, I also share the shoes of the parents right here on this call. It's not an easy job. But we know that you are your child's first teacher, as the secretary said, and we're committed to their success in their life. You're committed that way. As lead of family outreach at the U.S. Department of Education, I champion parents as equal partners in education. But I learned most of how I come to this work from my own family, who showed up even when I didn't want them to. And they deeply partnered with my teachers and school leaders. See, I grew up in a family of educators where I saw the power of strong partnerships between home and school firsthand. And I bring that to the department, where we are committed to raising the bar for parent partnership. So what does that mean? First and foremost, we prioritize engaging parents directly, deeply listening, and putting what we learn into action through our parent empowerment pop-ups, roundtable listening sessions, and blogs. We are working to champion parents. And as the secretary mentioned, our sample questions for parents and families, you can find that at this QR code and on our website. That grew directly from parent listening. The administration is also investing unprecedented funds in education. And family engagement is funded through several of these programs, including our statewide family engagement centers, full-service community schools, parent resource center, and information centers that support parents of children with disabilities. But one of the things that we heard this from state, local, and school leaders, that they wanted more resources to build strong partnerships with parents. So we partnered for a 6-part family engagement learning series this spring and summer, and continue to enhance the resources that are available on our website. And importantly, we are intentionally integrating family engagement across the department's Raise the Bar priorities, which you'll hear more about tonight. So whether you are a parent, a family member, caregiver, educator, working for an organization that serves families, or all of the above, we are excited to have you here this evening as we celebrate the power of family engagement to support student success. Thank you.
Thank you, Cecily. It's clear that parent engagement is shaping much of the department's work. So many parents are focused on how their children are doing in school right now, especially when we know that the pandemic had such a big effect on children's academic achievement and outcomes. So to share more about how the Department of Education is helping students recover from the pandemic, we have Bernadine Futrell, Deputy Assistant Secretary in the agency's Office of Elementary and Secondary Education.
Good afternoon. Thank you so much, Grace. Hi. Hello, parents. It's so good to be with all of you tonight. It feels so good, and I can feel the energy from the Zoom. As Grace mentioned, I'm Dr. Bernadine Futrell. I'm a Deputy Assistant Secretary in the Office of Elementary and Secondary Education. I also think it's important for this group to know that I was also the Director of the Office of Head Start, and I had the honor of being the first Head Start baby to go on and lead the office. And so very committed and excited about an opportunity to talk about how we're connecting and supporting academics, academic recovery, and how that connects with connecting authentic engagement with parents. Today's webinar is really a celebration of parent involvement. I know We talk about different ways that we connect and grow, but the moment we are in right now is such an important moment in our history because we're all on the same page, in full agreement, and on the same page in full agreement that we know in order for us to raise the bar for all of our children, for your children, my children, every student in our schools, we must be united and we must learn and grow together with a clear focus on equity with our children at the center of that. And so that's why one of the ways we've operationalized equity here at the Department of Education is making sure that our policy and our actions are informed by communities, by families, by parents, by the perspective, because right now, what's effective and family and child-centered is happening in your homes, it's happening in schools. And so we need to hear that. As you've heard our secretary mention, this administration, we've engaged over 10,000 parents in our family engagement efforts to have those conversations about raising the bar. As a parent of a brand new middle school student and a fourth grader, I want to see authentic family engagement. We need it. As an educational policy leader, I know the research, I know it's effective, and I know that's how we move forward. I'll tell you, as a parent, I'm looking for clarity on what our children need to be successful. I want to know how the school plans to partner with me. I think about that in every decision that I make in this role at the department and when I drop my kids off in the morning. I was in the audience during the Principal of the Year celebration, and one of the principals mentioned that her goal was to have her school be a little bit of Disney that's full of wonder and awe, a little bit of Harvard or Howard with strong academic core, and a little bit of West Point with structure. And I said, well, as a parent, I want the same thing. And as an educational leader here at the department, we're trying to move the needle forward so that we can raise the bar so that every student can have that. Like our secretary, I'm a parent first. And you have, and I've seen firsthand what it means to have a productive, strong relationship with my school when it comes to building a thriving foundation for my child. And the importance of parent partnerships in our school is not just backed by research, but it's also backed by what we know right now. And we know that it benefits not only parents knowing and being connected to schools, but also our students benefit academically, socially, and emotionally from robust family engagement. As parents, we play a critical role in our children's lives by providing emotional support, guidance, and the resources for their education. You on the line, you influence your child's values, attitudes, and overall development, which impact our academic success. So how do we leverage that and move forward with that? We know from these last few years have been challenging for our children and our families. But our kids across the nation, they have shown resilience. And it's up to us right now as your Department of Education to have your back. And we do. That's why on day one and stepping into office, we worked to get our school doors back open for in-person learning. We got historic dollars, pandemic relief funds out the door to schools to really help offset and support the work that we know is effective for our students. And the way that these funds are being used and continue to be used really matters. We're working with our schools to ensure that they are using the funds and using evidence-based strategies to provide our students with extra support. And we're grateful and thankful that they're leading the way and they're also responding strong. Proud to report that over half of our schools are now offering high dosage tutoring. Many schools are extending learning time before and after school. And we also launched, in response to the president's call to action, the National Partnership for Student Success, which invites, in a partnership with the school, community organizations, faith-based organizations, and other adults to be involved and be connected or link, I like to say, link elbows with us as parents. And so I'm grateful for that. But our work is not done. We're continuing our key grant programs to ensure that our schools provide strong academic support through literacy. We're working with our schools every step of the way to make sure that their programs are even more stronger. But today is about a celebration, and it's about a thank you and a gratitude. The work that we're doing together is important because when we engage as parents and when schools engage, we build a community and we build trust. And that allows us to ensure that your voice, parents' voices are at the table. And that's what we know can be true. And when we partner, we begin to reflect our communities. This real family engagement, authentic partnership that we're talking about allows us to place a spotlight on equity. I'll tell you, as a parent, it was hard to come back post-pandemic. I would take the long way to school to drop my kids off. But it was my child's principal who looked me in the eye and said, we're going to take care of them. We have your back. Call me. Be connected. And that's the authentic family engagement that I want to see for every family, every community. Because when we reconnect our children and families to this educational life system that we know is effective, it benefits every child in every community. And so the work that we're doing right now at the U.S. Department of Education and the work that I'm doing as Mike and Melanie's mom, I can tell you, I'm committed to raising the bar for every student. And I thank you for your partnership. And with that, back to you, Grace.
Thank you, Mike and Melanie's mom, Bernadine. We know that children need to feel safe in schools. And in order to achieve that at the highest levels, so with that in mind, we have Deputy Assistant Secretary Ruth Ryder, who oversees the department's efforts in making critical investments to help schools provide welcoming, nurturing, and safe environments for learning for every child. Ruth, over to you.
Thank you so much, Grace, and thank you all for the opportunity to be here with you on National Parent Involvement Day. I'd like to share a few thoughts on school safety and the work that is going on in the department to make sure that every child is attending a school that's safe and welcoming. We know school safety is top of mind these days. As a parent and a grandparent, I know we all want schools that provide safe, inclusive, and supportive learning environments where all children can thrive. To achieve this, it's important for educators and families to have opportunities to form relationships built on mutual trust and respect. Educators and families are important partners in addressing students' social, emotional, behavioral, and academic well-being. When students need additional support, effective educator and family engagement is critical for student success. An effective partnership can lead to decreased student disciplinary issues, improved parent-teacher and teacher-student relationships, and improved school environment, a safer environment. And that's what we all want for our children and grandchildren, right? Education leaders, such as superintendents, administrators, principals, all play critical roles in making educational environments safer, more supportive, and more equitable. There are also some simple practices in schools that we know are effective, such as teaching students how to manage their own behavior and learn from mistakes. We all want our children to have self-discipline, and parents play an important role in that. Another effective practice is increased staff presence in the hall, in the lunchroom, on the playground, and so on. And really critical is making sure that every child has at least one trusted adult in the school. We know how important connectedness in school is. We hear so often from adults how they had that one teacher or the bus driver or the principal that made a really critical difference in their life. Making sure all students understand the see something, say something rule is also really important. You may, as a parent, sometimes have questions about safety issues at your school. You should always feel comfortable talking to the school personnel, your child's teacher, your building principal, a school counselor, or social worker. They're always there to help you, and they want to hear from you. You're partners with them in this important work for your child. But sometimes we know that you might want to talk with someone else, someone who has been where you are as a parent. We're fortunate in the department to fund parent and family engagement centers, and they can help. The Parent Training and Information Centers, the PTIs, and there's one in every state, some states have more than one, are specifically designed to support parents of children with or suspected of having a disability, but they'll listen to you and help you where they can. In addition, the statewide family engagement centers, and you heard Cicely mention those, are also a good source of information and support for families. These are just two examples of the department's investments that are specifically designed to support parents and families. We also fund a number of technical assistance centers that develop and disseminate incredible resources and information, way too many for me to talk about here. There's a link at the bottom of your slide, and some other links have gone in the chat that will help you get to the resources that are available through the department. Today, I wanted to mention one specific resource document, Growing Up Drug-Free. Safety in school means children understanding the hazards of drug use. My oldest grandson just moved into high school. He's a freshman. James is a good kid, but I know my son and daughter-in-law are talking to him about the hazards of drugs these days. There's no experimenting with drugs. They're just too dangerous. The document that you can see on the screen was developed between Ed and the Department of Justice, and it was recently updated and is now available in Spanish. It includes basic information about types of drug use, including vaping, fentanyl, opioids, etc., but also includes guidelines for how to talk to your child, whether your child is a preschooler, elementary age, secondary age, or in college. And sometimes just starting that conversation is so important. This is a really useful resource. There are many others, as I said, too many to talk about, but I hope you will go to our website. Thank you all so much for being here and joining us in this important work. I appreciate your hard work as a parent. I think being a parent is one of the hardest jobs that we'll ever do, and appreciate your continued efforts to make our country the best place possible for our children and grandchildren. Back to you, Grace.
Thank you, Ruth. I'm sure your grandson appreciates you. So children's physical safety is hugely important, as is their psychological safety, which contributes to their overall well-being. And I hear that the department has made supporting students' mental health a key priority. And to tell us more, we have with us Katie Neese, who oversees the department's efforts in this space as Deputy Assistant Secretary in the Office of Special Education and Rehabilitative Services.
Thanks so much, Grace, and thank you everyone for joining us this evening. I'd like to start with a simple why. For students to thrive at school, they need a strong foundation of overall wellness. When suicide is the second leading cause of death for individuals between the ages of 10 and 24, we have a profound sense of urgency to act. Over the last 18 months, the department's focused on two major priorities: increasing the supply of school-based mental health professionals and increasing access to Medicaid reimbursement for school-based health and mental health services. I know from experience that having the right mental health professional, having your child get to that person, can make all the difference in the world. My own daughter really struggled with mental health in high school, and her friends outed her to the school counselor, who called my husband and I and shared with us what was really going on with her. If it wasn't for that call, our daughter would have really struggled even more than she had, and we were able to find the help for her that she needed. And today she is a happy, healthy graduate student pursuing a career in mental health. And it really did all come back to that one school counselor who was her safe place, her person at school. And we are forever grateful for her. But personnel shortages are among the leading factors that limit schools' ability to provide mental health services to students. That's why we've invested in grants to make sure schools have enough mental health professionals to meet the needs of all of our students. At the national level, I'm happy to report that we have more school-based mental health social workers, counselors, and nurses than we did before the pandemic, but we still need tens of thousands more. We're also measuring the number of community health centers with school-based sites. We've doubled the number of sites over the last 2 years, making it easier for our students to access health and mental health services without having to leave the building. And as I said earlier, we're also working to make it easier for schools to support students' overall wellness by making sure they have the resources to get the job done and meet the needs of our kids. And the last thing I would say is kids are struggling with all sorts of things. They are struggling with the regular kid stuff of navigating relationships with their peers, but lots of other kids are facing trauma at home or in their communities, and school needs to be that safe place for them. And so that is driving our work each and every day. So Grace, let me turn it back to you. And again, thank you all for joining us this evening.
Thanks, Katie, especially for sharing your personal story. So we've spent some time chatting about giving children a strong foundation of safety, overall well-being, and excellent academic learning. Now let's talk about how we can best prepare children for the future as they're thinking about college, workforce training, and ultimately getting ready for a fulfilling career. And the department has an initiative called Unlocking Career Success. And to fill us in, we'll turn things over to Assistant Secretary for Career, Technical, and Adult Education, Amy Lloyd.
Thank you so much, Grace. Cache, buenas noches. Hi, everyone. I am here tonight both as the person who has the huge honor to serve our country and leading the department's efforts at the intersection of education, workforce development, and economic development. But like so many of us here, I'm also here as a mom of a teenager. My daughter's in 11th grade. She's currently considering a huge array of ideas and choices about her future. So I'm on this journey with all of you, and I know how much it matters. Every day here at the department, every single one of us wakes up and thinks about our students and their families and how our nation's education system can better support our young people to engage in dynamic and joyful and rewarding pathways that ultimately empower our students and families to have real choices, for you to be able to make informed decisions about their futures. And we know, as so many of my wonderful colleagues have said, and as the secretary kicked us off, that our parents and our aunties and uncles and grandparents and other caregivers, but our families, our parents are our students' first, best, and most influential, important teachers. And that's why our students' parents and families, why you, are so essential to helping our young people understand and navigate the wide horizon of career pathways possibilities before them. Right now, the Biden-Harris administration is investing in America with trillions of dollars, going to grow our nation's economy in in-demand, high-wage fields. The world of work is rapidly shifting, and new jobs are being created in all these leading edge and technology-driven areas that frankly didn't even exist when all of us who are now parents were considering our own futures. And that's why we want our schools to better partner with business and industry and post-secondary education to build systems of career and college pathways that lead to bright futures, and to do so through collaboration and communication closely with the people we serve, our students and parents and families. We know parents and families are essential to student success. Every single young person, regardless of what their big dreams are, what their plans are for life after high school, every single young person is headed to a job, and ideally to a really good job that launches a career. And the majority of good jobs today and into the future require some form of post-secondary education. We want to set every single one of our students up for success, starting early, and help them to understand that learning and upskilling is going to be a lifelong journey for them. And we think our students may earn their first credential. They might then go to work. Then their employer might pay for them to go back to school to earn their next post-secondary credential. And we want to lift up and honor that post-secondary education takes many forms, all of which are valuable in today's economy, and all of which are first-class choices, not last resorts. So this can mean a technical school, a community and technical college. I went to two different community colleges myself. I love them. It could be a four-year college or university. It could be a registered apprenticeship or workforce development training. Whatever it may be, navigating pathways from high school to post-secondary education to a career should be like the best highways we have in our nation. So clearly marked signs communicating where you are, where you're going, how long it's going to take you to get there, options to turn left or take an exit and go in a new direction if you so choose, and lots of opportunities for off-ramps and on-ramps to make stops along your long journey without any dead ends. we want career pathways to always provide more opportunities for our students to continue to travel, to learn, to grow on their lifelong journeys. And to drive on that highway, our vision is that every single student will leave high school with four keys to unlock their career success. And I've got them listed here. One is college credit to give them some momentum towards that first post-secondary credential. The second is real-world paid work-based learning experiences through internships and apprenticeships in the world of work. The third is an industry-sought workforce credential. What are employers putting on their job descriptions that signify that those are the skills they're looking for, so our students can with confidence use their skills and find jobs in the labor market? And the fourth is a plan that's informed by you, our parents and families, to achieve their career and college ambitions, whatever they may be. And so we encourage you to check out our Unlocking Career Success website to learn more about these four keys and to learn more about our work that Secretary Cardona has charged us to reimagine high schools, to provide career and college pathways that are so much more community engaged, career connected, and student and family centered in all that we do. And please let us know how we can support you as you're supporting our young people to dream big about and prepare for their future, because that's our future. We are all invested in the future of our young people. So gracias, Alakwet. Thanks again. And I really appreciate you joining us here this evening. Back to you, Grace.
Thank you so much, Amy. I hope your 11th grader finds their path to success. Young people definitely deserve more opportunities to thrive, and it's clear that you're addressing that need. From credentials to apprenticeship, providing students with pathways to college and career in and careers in high school and even earlier can give them a leg up in a competitive economy. And speaking of college, we know that many parents are concerned about the cost of higher education. And the department has been doing a lot of work on college affordability. And to share more about that, we'll hear from Undersecretary of Education, James Quall. James, over to you.
Thank you so much, Grace. It's really a delight to be here with all of you to share some work on making it easier for families to pay for college and to help students earn degrees. I'm also a parent. I have a toddler at home, so I'm also looking forward to getting home, hopefully in time for bedtime. But here at the department, we help young people pay for colleges, universities, trade schools, all kinds of degrees and credentials after high school that can be a path to a steady job and a better life. And President Biden, Secretary Cardona are committed to making sure that path is affordable for everybody. So here's what we're working on. The first is the FAFSA, which is the application for federal student aid. And many families' college journey begins with the FAFSA. I'm really excited about the beta FAFSA we will be releasing this year. It's the biggest redesign of the form in its history, and it will be simpler and easier than ever. If you filled out the FAFSA before, you probably wouldn't have used the word simple and easy, but we're taking many questions off the form, and some students will be able to complete it in as little as 10 minutes. The Better FAFSA will also be able to offer more help to low-income students, making an additional 600,000 students eligible for Pell Grants for the first time. The FAFSA will be available by December 31st, and you can visit studentaid.gov for more information. Second part of our strategy is Pell Grants, and they are the foundation of federal student aid. Pell Grants are scholarships that help more than 6 million students a year pay for college. They are not loans, so they don't have to be repaid. And so far, President Biden has increased Pell Grants by up to $900 per student per year, up to about $7,400 per student. And he's asked Congress to double Pell Grants. That is a proposal that would reshape higher education, but it is one that fits into his responsible budget, and it is one that would be possible if we make the right choices. Third, we're investing in supporting colleges that too often are underfunded, even though they serve larger shares of first-generation students, low-income students, and students of color. And this includes community colleges, historically Black colleges and universities, and other minority-serving institutions. We've already invested more in these institutions than any other administration in history. Fourth, we're proud that President Biden continues to fight to make community college tuition free. And while Congress has not yet acted on this plan, the president's leadership has helped inspire states and communities across the country, from Massachusetts to New Mexico, to enact their own version of free college plans. And finally, we are working very hard on student loans. We've created a new repayment plan, the SAVE plan, which is the most affordable repayment plan ever. It allows you to repay your loans on a sliding scale based on how much you earn. We've also identified 3.6 million people who are eligible for loan forgiveness because they work in public service or have disability or other reasons. And we're going to keep working to get borrowers the benefits that they've earned. So we're making some big investments in higher education, and we're doing it because we think it is one of the best investments we can make in the future of our young people and our economy. So thanks for giving me a chance to talk about it. And back to you, Grace.
Well, before you rush off to bedtime, James, thank you for sharing this valuable information on today's webinar. I am certainly inspired. I've already signed on to teach my daughter's fifth grade class how to write a news headline. Wish me luck, and I can't wait to get even more involved. For more about the department's work across these areas and how you can get even more informed, be a more informed advocate for your child, please visit ed.gov. So ed.gov/raise the bar. And now we'll hear from Deputy Secretary of Education, Cindy Martin, who is a lifelong advocate for children, having served as an educator, principal, and superintendent of schools. Thank you for having me.
Thank you so much, Grace, for moderating this whole webinar tonight. It's fabulous to have your voice, to have your moderation skills, and also to all my colleagues. As everybody could hear tonight, we're all parents. We started with our secretary talking about his most important title, and then about the roots. And if the roots aren't good, nothing else works. So, and then you heard each one of us as a parent. I also am a parent of a son who's now 28 years old. That doesn't seem possible. And I also watched my mother parent my older brother and my younger sister. My older brother having developmental disabilities and my younger sister experiencing severe mental illness. And watching my mom, and now as an adult, supporting my mom navigate systems to support her children. And then also supporting my son, who's now in a career that he chose and working in the field of sciences. It was not an easy path for him. So you know that we're bringing our parents' voice and passion in the work that we're doing at the federal level. Every single one of us cares so much about this work. If it's good enough for our own children, it's got to be good enough for the country. My son experienced a big loss when he was 13 years old, and his father, my husband, experienced a stroke that was debilitating. And if it were not for the engagement with school and meaningful engagement with the schools that supported him, he wouldn't be on the path that he's on right now. So we truly understand the importance of meaningful, authentic parent involvement and parent engagement. When I became a principal at an inner city school in San Diego, the first Family Friday I had, 10 parents came. And by the time I left 10 years later, we had 500 parents coming. What it takes to actually support our students and our communities is real meaningful engagement. So today at this evening, you got to hear about all of the ways at the department level we're supporting mental health, safe schools. What does academic excellence look like? What does career connected learning look like? How do we create those pathways? And then you heard about college affordability. All of these things put together is what it takes to raise the bar in education. But we can't do it alone. We do this together, we do it in community, and we give our children the best shot for the brightest future possible. And we know at the true heart of this is our parents and the schools and the communities in which the schools are. Students that have involved parents, we already know, are more likely to show up to school and stay motivated in classrooms. You are the ones that help increase achievement and help us get to on-time graduation rates. You set your kids on a path for success, and we do it together. We do it in partnership. Every action that we do together. So you know, as parents, you know what works firsthand, and your valuable feedback helps us navigate the complexities of raising our children. We want to continue to lift up the evidence-based strategies, the sustainable family engagement strategies that actually work that are meaningful so more parents can build very robust partnerships with their school communities. You're all here on this call tonight. You're probably navigating and juggling three or four things, making dinner, getting bedtime ready, doing all that, but you showed up here. Reach out to more parents that do this way of getting involved, the partnerships, and the way that you can reach out to your neighbor and say, hey, did you know about this? And sometimes it just takes a friendly hand or a neighbor saying, come on over to the school. Let's get involved together. Just know, as a Department of Education, we're here to not only learn from you, but to take meaningful action that we learn based on our experiences. I know together we can make a huge impact, and we all bring our parents' voice and our parents' hearts to this work. So let's turn it back over to our fabulous Secretary of Education with his parents' heart and educators' mind as we move forward in this work together. Secretary Cardona.
Hey, thank you so much, Cindy. What a wonderful, jam-packed 30 minutes. It actually took 45. It's kind of like the PTA meetings when I was a school principal. We just kept going because there was so much positive to share and to learn from one another. We're going to wrap this up now, but I just wanted to say thank you, Grace Bastidas. Thank you so much for being here. I look forward to a continued partnership. The panelists, you were amazing. Thank you. I have an amazing team at the department. You know, a lot of times you just see my face, but look, it's their work. There's thousands of people at the department that are serving your children. And we need to continue to listen to do a better job every single day. As you saw, we're parents first, right? I want to thank Cecily. Cecily, awesome job tonight. Thank you for your work. LaWanda, Allison, the events team that's putting this all together. And thank you all for staying on. And I appreciate those hearts. I see those. It means a lot to us, to all of us, man. We're in this together. We're committed to making sure we raise the bar across the country for every student. And I always say all means all. Every child deserves to be treated with respect, dignity, needs to be welcomed, needs to be seen for their assets, what they bring to the table. And it's our job to be your supporting cast. Thank you for being here with us tonight. More importantly, thank you for your partnership. I love this so much. I want to do more of this. So stay tuned because we're going to do this again. Check out our website for now for the resources and have a great night. Thank you.